Hello, Dr. Greer.
Hello.
I have prepared a bunch of questions.
Okay, sounds good.
So, the first one is obviously the following. In the media, there was information that the U.S. Senate obliged the intelligence agencies to disclose the information they have on the UFO issue. So, the question is, what is it going to be like on the surface? Will it be a meeting or a press conference or what? And what is going to happen in reality in 180 days, according to the information that you get?
Okay. Well, first of all, it's within 180 days. So it could be tomorrow, theoretically, number one. Number two, this was embedded in the COVID relief bill, in this 5,500-page bill, by staffers and people in the Senate Intelligence Committee who have ordered the Director of National Intelligence and the Pentagon and the FBI and the intelligence community to provide a report within that 180-day period. So now it's more like 160 days or something from this date today. What's actually going on, the backstory of this, because I just had a conversation with General Herbert a couple months ago, who was the Army general who retired and then became the staffer for Senator Harry Reid, who is retired now. But at the time, Senator Reid was the head of the Senate because he was Democrat, and the Democrats at that time controlled the Senate. And back some years ago, they put together a $22 million study authorized by the Senate and through the Pentagon funding that went to an outfit known as Bigelow Aerospace. Now, Bigelow Aerospace was based in Nevada, in Las Vegas, of course, which is the home state of Senator Reid. And Robert Bigelow, who founded and owned that company, was someone who I've known since I met him at the Rockefeller Ranch in 1993. And he is a man who inherited about $1 billion from his father in real estate, much of it connected to questionable activities. And he wanted to get on the inside of the UFO covert programs in the United States. And then he was intercepted by a man that I've known for many years named Colonel John Alexander, who has a PhD in thanatology, or death and decay. And he is part of this covert, unacknowledged special access project group. And he became the consigliere, or the sort of advisor to Bigelow, first in something called NIDS, the National Institute for Discovery Science, and then that morphed into Bigelow Aerospace. Now, what General Herbert didn't know, and what Senator Reid didn't know, is that those $22 million were channeled through covert intelligence operatives like Colonel Alexander to Bigelow Aerospace so that they would not get any honest answers. And so in my conversation, it's part of how they cover things up. They make it look like they're doing something when in reality, it's a decoy. It's a distraction. And so when I had this conversation a few months ago with General Herbert, he made it very clear that the information they were getting, even in the classified part of the briefings in the Senate SCIF, the Secure Communication Information Facility, underneath the Capitol, that's a secure facility, that they knew that they were getting basically a very limited amount of information, that most of it was being withheld. Now, what he didn't know is that that was the setup from the get-go. That was why it was channeled over to Bigelow Aerospace, because that is it was set up by Colonel Alexander to distract and pull those monies in a non-productive way and basically waste the $22 million. Ultimately, the general said, boy, he wished that he had had me advising him back when they put all that money out. And I said, no, I understand that, but that's why they keep you guys ignorant of what's actually happening. So the result of that is that they put into an authorization bill the provision for doing another study. And I knew about that this summer. So, and that was going to proceed. What they did, therefore, was then hide in this COVID relief bill a provision for this 180-day study. Now, what that's going to be is that it's going to be another whitewash cover-up. They will provide, there will be two parts of the study. One will be publicly released, and then there'll be a part that'll be classified. But even the part that'll be classified will have no significant information in it. This is how those operate. Neither the president nor the key committees in the Senate are ever told the actual truth about this subject. Now, of course, I have several hundred top secret sources in corporations and CIA and Pentagon who provide information to my group. So we know what's actually going on. But these studies that go through the bureaucracy, let's call it, of the Pentagon and the CIA, they usually deliberately remove anything of any real importance. For example, it was made clear to me that both the president and the vice president were given half-truths, part of the information, and the part that they put in was false was that the extraterrestrials were a threat to the national security. The part they left out, which is the most important part, is that they are not a threat, but that there are covert programs that have man-made UFOs that are fully operational that they have not told the president or the Senate Intelligence Committee about, which have been kept secret so that they can be used in a false flag surprise attack made to look alien, but completely run by covert operations. And by the way, it would also affect your country as well. This is a global problem. It's not just U.S. So the reason that these releases that appear to be disclosures are happening is to lay the foundation for their stepping stones, as Carol Ross and I have discussed, to the big one, and that is to have a false disclosure of the alien threat that would serve to grow a militaristic, totalitarian, fascist global response to the extraterrestrial presence and to justify increasingly putting assets into space and uniting the world around a threat. So there are, you know, two ways that people can see uniting the planet. One is through cooperation in space, through cooperation internationally, through peace, and more enlightened paths, people who profit enormously from the military-industrial complex think it's best to unite the world around another enemy. And since the global terrorism threat has become less and less, and no one really believes that we're going to launch nuclear weapons with China and Russia, the only way they can grow their business is to then exaggerate and hoax a threat from outer space. That's been a plan for about 70 years, or a little over 60 years, since the late 50s. And what this report is doing, and the reason it's being leaked to the public through mainstream news outlets here in the United States, just like the event we talked about last time with the Tic Tac and the Pentagon releasing the footage of our Navy jets chasing the UFOs off the coast of California, those are all programmed, scheduled leaks that are designed to attach to them this narrative of there being a national security threat. So that's what's going on. And it's being picked up not just in U.S. media, but global media in the United Kingdom and other countries. The other thing that just happened today, I think perhaps I shared this with you, is that there's a big breaking news story about the CIA releasing a great many documents. Those documents actually have been online for some time. What they're doing, they sanitized and removed some really important documents, and they're making it look like they're, quote, coming clean, when in reality, the most important information, as usual, is being withheld. And the reason for even releasing all those documents and making it into a mainstream news story, since in the United States, the mainstream news media does not cover this subject unless they are ordered to by the CIA, is that they are wanting all of this to hit the mainstream awareness as a way of educating people and opening the door to the second level of the main narrative, and that is there's an extraterrestrial threat out there. So that's always been the long-term plan. It's been a big part of the secrecy. It's also been a main reason why the aerospace researchers I have on my team, who have several hundred thousand pages of documents and designs of man-made anti-gravity UFO objects, we have these. Those have never been briefed to the president or to members of the Senate Intelligence Committee, because if they were to know that those exist, then it would remove the element of surprise of using them in an apparent attack or some kind of threatening action from, quote unquote, the aliens. So it's all very much hoax. I mean, it's a cosmic level of what happened when Vice President Dick Cheney manufactured the false evidence saying is having weapons of mass destruction, and then sent Colin Powell, the Secretary of State, who had been Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, to the United Nations with false evidence. And that justified the coalition going in and destroying Saddam Hussein's military, and also taking their oil reserves off the market so that the price of oil would skyrocket to over $100 a barrel. That's what that was all about, because both Bush Sr. and Cheney were oil people. So that there are always agendas that are actually responsible for these events. Now, if you look at the disaster that happened in the Middle East that we're still living through the repercussions of, by going into Iraq, when, of course, Saddam Hussein had nothing to do with 9/11, is that this was done for very strategic reasons. One of those reasons was to be able to pass the Patriot Act, which allowed for domestic surveillance and the extension of the surveillance state in the United States on its own people, but also around the world. It also, which of course is unconstitutional in our country, I know in some countries it's de rigueur, and kind of normalized, but in this country, allegedly, we're not supposed to have the state spying on its citizens. In reality, it was found that all telephone, electronic, and internet were in fact being monitored in real time for everyone in the United States and around the world through Carnivore and Echelon, and then later, of course, Snowden exposed the PRISM program, which was just an updated version of Echelon and Carnivore, which were projects at the National Security Agency for Signals Intelligence. And as you know, the COVID virus was absolutely a man-made virus that was designed to do precisely what it is doing, and that is to bring the Western economy to its knees, but more importantly, to allow the state to impose restrictions on movement, on gathering, on free speech. That is the main purpose. I mean, if the virus hadn't been intended, I know the top geneticists in the world who've looked at it, if they had wanted to make it very, very lethal so that it would have killed 20% of everyone who got it, they could have. They didn't, for a reason. It's doing precisely what it was designed to do. So on the heels of the COVID disaster around the world and the reaction to it, which in many cases, some of it is warranted. A lot of it has been overdone for the purposes of exercising the suspension of freedoms of the people. I have a member of my team who was the chief top scientist at the Naval Research Labs, NRL. The Naval Research Labs were founded by Thomas Edison. They're in Southwest Washington, D.C. I've been in the facility. The man who is the head of their top scientists routinely did briefings for the vice president and senior officials in the government. And they dealt with a lot of classified and top secret operations, including the creation of electronic propulsion systems that look like little UFOs floating around the hangars out there. I was in there, and this is not an urban myth. This is a fact. But prior to 9/11, he was in the office of the Vice President of the United States, Dick Cheney, and personally saw the plans for 9/11. Now, this is not a conspiracy theory. This is an absolute fact from the person who was in there. He's been at my home. His name is Richard Foch, F-O-C-H. He's now passed away from prostate cancer. And he was told that if he ever spoke of this publicly, that he and his family and children and grandchildren would all be assassinated. He was told that point blank. But what happened was that the attacks that happened on 9/11, similar to the Capitol siege, happened because we deliberately and clandestinely stood down the intercept and security systems to prevent it. So we knew this was incoming, but we also took specific actions to be sure it wasn't intercepted and stopped. That was an inside job. This is all very worrisome because it looks like they're standing up in our country chaos that would enable them to tighten the grip of power, sustain more and more of our freedoms at the same time that they're pushing this, what I call fake disclosure, the disclosure that serves their secret interests. And as you know, I wrote a paper in 1999 called When Disclosure Serves Secrecy, that we had seen the plans that they would eventually bring this whole issue out and through the mainstream media and government, which they're now doing 22 years later, but in a way that presents it as an existential threat and a national security threat. And so now we're seeing that happen. And of course, you know, Carol Rosen had learned that that was the plan from Wernher von Braun back in the 70s. So unfortunately, I can't say that this is very good news, because in the UFO, people who study this subject, they think, oh, isn't it great that the government's coming clean and is telling people the truth? I said, no, it isn't, because they're not telling the truth. They're telling a partial truth that serves the interests of war in space, not peace in space. So that's the missile that's been launched. It's an information missile. And I think it needs to be countered by people who are more educated and more enlightened and have peaceful purposes in your country, my country, and around the world. But I can tell you that we're on a very short timeline. The countdown has started with this report, and we're going to try. I'm working with some people on my team who know the senior Democratic leadership and the senior Republican leadership, such as Senator Marco Rubio, who is currently the head of the Senate Intelligence Committee, to get them the truth about this and to do some private briefings as a non-governmental agency. I mean, I don't have any official standing, but what we're trying to do is to be a truth teller and a check and a balance against this false information, disinformation that's being pushed out. And the fact that the mainstream media is covering this so heavily, and that the government is every single week in the United States, there's a new mainstream news story about this. But with the particular spin that it's a national security threat, this is extremely alarming. And it's on the heels and within the context, let's say the milieu, the environment of the COVID lockdowns, the suspension of internet freedoms and speech, the attack on the Capitol. And it looks like they're even trying to agitate this to the point that we could be looking at big civil unrest in the United States in the coming months if we're not careful, which would, of course, be very dangerous given the power the United States has in the world. This is not a place where you want to see it go into complete chaos like other, developing countries have during the Civil War, and which we did in the 1800s, but this is 2021. We, cannot have a situation like that. And if we do, it would endanger world security very significantly. For your country, I don't think the concern is so much that in the next eight or nine days that a nuclear missile is going to be launched or anything like that. I understand that people have spoken to the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. There are assurances that any crazy order from the current president would not be taken, that those would basically not be followed. So that's probably not the issue. The bigger issue, and this gets into a little more complex discussion, is that these international interests, they're not U.S., they're global interests that would like to see conflict. They don't care about United States or Russia or China. They care about a global totalitarian elitist regime. And they have assets that would mimic or would actually look like a launch from the United States or Russia that would, in the time of chaos, be convincing. Just like they have assets that would look like an alien attack on our planet using these man-made, very advanced aircraft that really do look like ET craft, but also they have electronic and other type of weapon systems on them that are extremely dangerous, such as the ones we talked about last time, where on satellites they have electronic electromagnetic field weapons where they can target a volume of space over, say, a country and turn that system on, and all aircraft in that volume of space fall out of the sky and crash. That's how most of Saddam Hussein's Air Force was neutralized, by the way. I have a man who worked on that system and saw it being deployed in Iraq during that war. So I think we have to, I think this is where it gets really important, where your military and intelligence folks and your political leadership need to get informed about this and stay calm, but also need to know that there are deceptive activities that could happen that may not be coming from where it looks like it's coming from. Whether it could be made to look alien, it could also be made to look U.S. when it isn't, and vice versa. So this is, of course, creates a big problem. I know that some years ago when I was at the Pentagon, I was briefing the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, which is, the top guy, director of the Defense Intelligence Agency for military intelligence in the United States, and then three-star general Patrick Hughes. And he had not been read into any of these projects. And he had concluded, and the reason I had the meeting with him, is that he was basically what we call in the United States a sitting duck. He was very vulnerable to a surprise use of these assets that are man-made. And he would have no idea where it was coming from. He wouldn't know if it was Russian, China, or from the Andromeda Galaxy. Because he had been deliberately deceived on the existence of these very advanced technologies that are in the Lockheed Skunk Works and Northrop Grumman and other big aerospace contractors that work with these classified projects. And similarly, people in your country, if they are not adequately prepared and informed, they could be surprised in a way that would catch them off guard, and they would make false assumptions. And this is why I think, I keep saying knowledge is power. This knowledge and this information is extremely important for military commanders, people in charge of governments and security to know. If they don't know it exists, they're vulnerable to being deceived by it. Not what you wanted to hear, perhaps. That's what's happening in this crazy country.
Well, it was impressive. I guess their goal is to dominate the world or to raise money or what?
It's about power. I mean, it's about global domination and power. Look, I mean, you know, transnational. And I use the word transnational, not international. Let me explain the difference of what I mean. International would be Russia talking to the United States or the UN or what have you. Transnational goes beneath the surface of geopolitical borders of a nation state or a country into a global interest, which is, quite frankly, fascist. What people don't realize is that at the end of World War II, Russia, the Soviet Union, and America and England thought they won the war. Well, they won the battle. They did not win the war. The war went covert. And as I don't know if I shared this with you, there's a man on my team who is the grandson of Paul Mellon. Paul Mellon was one of the few billionaires in the world at the end of World War II. And as you know, he and Watson of IBM and Henry Ford of Ford Motors and Prescott Bush of the Bush oil family were all very big supporters of Adolf Hitler until the day war was declared. At that point, they became quiet and stood down. But when the war was over, Paul Mellon, his grandson, told me this directly while I was sitting at the Watergate condos in Washington, where he has this huge place. And this Paul Mellon's grandson is the son of this Senator John Warner I referred to earlier. Well, his son, John Warner IV, if you want to look him up, who's a historian and author and about my age, maybe a little younger, he said, look, you know, his grandfather, Paul Mellon, whose daughter married Senator Warner, he said, look, one night Paul Mellon had had a couple too many martinis and told him the whole story of what happened at the end of World War II. And he said Paul Mellon and Alan Dulles and George Patton went into Germany and retrieved some early, very high-tech electromagnetic field propulsion systems that were being worked on but were not perfected. They were brought back in the United States. General Patton wanted to disclose this information to the public because he saw it as a great scientific breakthrough. And because he was pushing for that, he was assassinated by the intelligence community, made to look like a car accident. Now, this is directly said to me by Paul Mellon's grandson. By the intelligence community, made to look like a car accident. Now, this is directly said to me by Paul Mellon's grandson. And what they did is that they instituted a project to bring in the top Nazis and people into the United States who were really scientists. They didn't care about the politics or fascism or anything else. But the people who wanted to benefit from that technology and who started the CIA and who started these covert programs in the United States were and are fascists. This is what people have to understand. Now, that word gets thrown around a lot now with the Antifa movement, what have you. I'm using it in the literal sense, where they really are believers in the fascist order. But instead of doing it in a clumsy way, which is what Germany did, they've done it in a more sophisticated way, covertly. And so their intention is to have a global, a totalitarian, fascist sort of power within the in the world. But the way they see the short path to getting there is to present the world with a threat that isn't based on the Earth, but that's coming from space. And these are really some not well people. These are people who have some crazy ideas. But the roots of it were in people who were true believers in fascist totalitarian systems. And that included people like Paul Mellon, who was very instrumental in forming, our modern day CIA that had been evolved out of the OSS, if you look up the history back at the end of World War II. So that's really what we're dealing with this group. It has, gone through many iterations of evolution and has sort of like a cancer metastasized in various institutions and places around the world. And I think that that's really something that is never talked about where it should be. And that's in governmental circles, because they're always fighting the last war. I don't even think most people who are in these circles in government that I've talked to even have an awareness of what they're up against and what's really behind the curtain pulling all the levers. And this isn't a conspiracy theory. These are facts that can be documented. But I think that the way the public has this presented to them is that it's some kind of crazy theory. It is a theory. It's actually the facts of how it's been structured and how power in the world is being orchestrated. They want to expand that power so that it isn't just one country here and there, but where it becomes a sort of a global power, which I'm all in favor of world peace and world unity and interplanetary contact, of course, but they're wanting to do this for the 180 degree opposite reasons, and that is to centralize military power and keep the people in a state of fear. Robert Kennedy Jr. recently did a great little program where he included a discussion about how Goebbels was on the witness stand during the Nuremberg trials, I believe it's Nuremberg, was asked, how did you get the entire German public to go along with this? He says, fear. It was easy. He was very glib. He said, it's fear. So what you're seeing with the COVID fear, the siege on the Capitol fear, the alien threat fear, is that when people are absolutely in a state of fear, they want to turn to some big power to protect them. This happens in your country. It happens in my country. They want to turn to Big Brother. They want to turn to someone that's going to give them security. And that's how these demagogues amass power. And they're very effective at it. They're very good at it. They've had many, many decades of practice at doing this. Unfortunately, at this stage, the organs of covert programs in government and in the media are such that they're pushing very heavily towards moving the alien issue to the forefront, but in a way that's a threat to the world. And it's going to be portrayed not just a threat to the United States, it'll be presented as a global threat. And this is why I think, your country and more enlightened people in this country and all around the world need to form a coalition to get ahead of this, Unfortunately, it's too late if we do it reactively. If we want to keep this space preserved for peace and keep weapons out of space and keep us from going into this sort of downward spiral, it's going to take some people who actually exhibit leadership, who are at the heads of different governments, your government, my government, China, Britain, India, all around the world. And someone needs to coordinate that and spearhead it. Now, of course, obviously, I'm a private citizen with no standing or power whatsoever, except the knowledge I have. But I think that, which is what it is, but officially, I have no standing at all. And I don't care to, frankly. But I think that that's what needs to happen. Do people need to have advice? They need to have a very deep briefing on this. They need to find people in other countries with similar views and understanding. Because if they do this reactively, it's a little bit like trying to react after 9/11. Once that happened, a whole chain of events took place that led to the Iraq War, the Mideast War, the Patriot Act, on and on and on and on. 20 years later, we're still in the aftermath of that. So it's, as we say in America, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. I think we need to do some proactive, preventative actions from Russia, from America, from other countries, where we have a countervailing force, that we have a message that is the opposite and that is truthful. And of course, that's why I left my medical career to found the Disclosure Project and the Drive Initiative. But I think that's where we're reaching a point now where it's all coming to a head. I mean, I know that Carol Raza and I have discussed the fact that what we have seen coming and what we've been told is coming is now here. It isn't that it's decades away. It's coming. It's happening around us right now. So there's a matter of some great urgency here.
So as I understand correctly, these people are in possession of modern technologies that the world has never seen. Only they have seen that, and they are planning to use it to hoax an alien invasion, so the world can unite against this threat. And that's how they escalate fear, and that's how they will, they are planning to gain power.
Yes, and that's one way. I mean, you have to remember, they've already been doing this for about 50 years. For example, when there's a test flight accident of one of these aircraft, it's portrayed as an alien event that hurt people. This is what happened outside Houston, Texas, in, I believe it was the early 1980s. It's called the Cash Landrum event, where we have an Air Force intelligence officer that we have his test, where he stated very directly, as the principal investigator for the Air Force out of Kirkland Air Force Base, he was sent to investigate this event where from the Nellis Range, what the public call Area 51, that's not what it's called. That's all fake, by the way. The real terms are, you know, S4, S12, Pahoot Mesa, Groom Lake, what have you. So there was an extraterrestrial vehicle that we had captured that they had been studying at that facility underground. They could not get the power, the energy system on it to work. So they very stupidly put on a plutonium or a nuclear reactor on it. But once they got the power system working, the electronics worked to make this thing float and anti-gravity. So there were four human pilots on this extraterrestrial craft that was running on an American-made nuclear power plant, that when it was being test flown out of Nellis to a Air Force base in Texas, it malfunctioned and it started spewing radioactive waste. It's like Chernobyl in the air on the people down below who were poisoned and very critically injured. And this was all in the media. Now, they were happy to have the UFO community, who are, of course, a bunch of hobbyists and morons in America for the most part. I mean, it's not polite to say that, but they are, to think this was an alien attack, all right? So that accident, they allowed to go through the public as a UFO event that injured humans, because that serves their purpose of portraying the aliens as a threat. When in reality, it was an accident, the total fault of which was the United States' unacknowledged special access projects that were running these projects out of Nellis Air Force Base. I use that as a very illustrative example of things that have happened over the years that have built up the public gullibility to believe the aliens are a threat. So you take that case, multiply it 1,000 times. That's what you're dealing with.
And this all besides the Hollywood movies like Alien, like Independence Day.
Yeah, it's very effective. And unfortunately, the public, because I think that there's something that in a deeper, this is more of a deeper bioevolutionary analysis. Humans have a proclivity to, and this is the foundations of tribalism, racism, to be afraid of anything that's too strange and too different. This is why, you know, you black versus white or one ethnic group versus another. Humans tend to be very monkey-like in terms of tribes. And so there's the white tribe, and there's the Christian tribe, and the Muslim tribe, and, you know, the Protestant tribe, and the Orthodox Russian tribe, and the Catholic tribe, and the Hindu tribe, and the on and on and on and on and on and on and on. So the history of humans is that that can be exploited. Now you introduce something that is more foreign than a different race or religion or tribe, another species from another planet. And that bioevolutionary proclivity, tendency to go straight to fear of the unknown and straight to fear of a life form that's different from you, and to then have that turn into hatred and warfare, that's what they're exploiting. They're exploiting that built-in flaw, let's call it. Maybe that's the real original sin of humans. They're exploiting that built-in flaw in humans, because by exploiting that, it keeps people outwardly directed towards our differences instead of considering what is our point of oneness, which is the conscious spirit within you and me and the ETs and all life. And that's that field of universal a consciousness. And that's the foundation of universal peace. So, but what they're doing, what these demagogues do, is exploit. And we've seen religious leaders do this, political leaders do it, racist people do it. I grew up in the South in the United States, where I saw this all the time. I had a black girlfriend in high school and almost got run over and killed by a bunch of white supremacists because they didn't like I had a black girlfriend. They were intending to kill me. Now, this was in 1972 or three, a long time ago, when I was 16, 17. But that kind of behavior, people in the intelligence community know how to exploit. And that's what they're doing. And the ultimate exploitation of that tendency that humans have, that we need to transcend and go beyond, but we've been stuck there, is being done with the alien issue, because that's the ultimate other. It's not only is it a different, it's not like it's just a different race or tribe of humans. It's a totally different species from another star system, another planet. So that is ripe for exploitation by people who are masters of manipulation and psychological warfare. And that is also a big part of how they operate.
What exactly is going to happen when they play this last card scenario? Are there going to appear these man-made flying saucers or what?
Well, first of all, my goal and your president's goal must be to prevent that from happening. That's number one. It can be prevented. If it hasn't happened yet, it's preventable. So what I would say is, let's focus on preventing something that is preventable. And, you know, the old expression, if something, you know, you shine sunlight in a dark corner and it's the best disinfectant. And so we need to put light on this subject, and we need to not only expose it, but then come up with positive plans for space, for our military, for our governments on this issue, because I think there's another scenario that can unfold. Because back in the 1970s, I have a lot of lucid dreams where I see the future. I've always been like that. You know, they call it remote viewing or precognition. And I saw a time when I was much older, like now, and I was out in the desert Southwest. It looked like White Sands, where the first atomic weapon was detonated. And this beautiful event happened. The military, the people around the world had acknowledged that we weren't alone. And there was an open contact event that was being orchestrated and supported, where the military were protecting the event and space so that an ET craft could come and land, and an elder, an extraterrestrial elder, would emerge. And he did. And the whole world was watching this. And it was a unifying, beautiful, very spiritual opening of a whole new era. And this was a crystal clear lucid dream. Broad daylight, the whole world watching it, and leaders from all over the world there as this event took place. Now, that event could have, in fact, happened in the 50s. It could have happened in the 60s, in the 90s, in the 2000s. I believe it can still happen, but it isn't going to happen by itself. We're going to have to get people around the world to openly discuss this issue, put these dark forces on a leash. You know, some people have called this the initial period of world peace is going to be the peace of the chained dogs. I mean, there's some rabid dogs are going to have to be put on a chain and put, you know, quiet. But I think this is possible. So first I would like to say is I don't think this scenario needs to happen. And I think it's still preventable. There's still time. Secondly, if it does happen, if enough people in the Kremlin and in Washington and in China and in London and at Whitehall understand that these assets are there, they're not going to be deceived by it. So if they're not deceived by it, they won't take the wrong actions that they are planning them to take. I mean, the people who, you know, if you pull a stunt like this, if you do a trick like this, it only works if people know it's a trick, you know, don't know it's a trick. If they do know it's a trick and it's false, they go, look, we know what you're doing. We're not going to buy into this. So how we react to something like that is very dependent on people having the facts and the knowledge and the truth. And I don't mean just me. I mean people in senior positions in government around the world who can then talk to each other and say, look, let's not react to this because it is most likely this scenario that Dr. Greer and Wernher von Braun and others over the years have talked about. So I think that if that's known, then people can avoid overreacting in a way that is very dangerous. So I think that's what needs to happen. And that's this whole concept of an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure, that, you know, if you do something to prevent it, it's much better than trying to come up with a scenario to react to it after the fact. But then if it does happen, I think that what happens in the aftermath of that, if it's handled improperly, could result in an extinction level event for our planet. So I think that it's very serious. And I think that the only way to avoid the worst outcomes is to bring people together very honestly, have open discussions about this. But also what I'm working on is getting this information out to the public. I'm in the process in the last 48 hours of putting together an emergency educational documentary to reach about a billion people, maybe 2 billion people, exposing all of this. So I'm working on that very, very heavily, which is why I need some people from Russia to go be interviewed for this. The head of Facebook for North America has offered to push this out to 3.8 billion people on Facebook, for example, who I've been talking with in the last day or two. I don't know what we're going to do with it, but I have authorized the funding to create this educational documentary to put out globally prior to June, when this report is due from to the Congress. So I'm going to work very, very hard on getting that accomplished.
Great idea. So are you going to interview Russian side as well?
Yes, that's what I'm asking you to help with. If you and Carol Rosin can help us identify people who could speak to this with authority and in a way that supports the agenda for preventing the placement of weapons in space, preserving peace for space, and to the extent that they know anything, where they can comment on, you know, what Russia as a government, how they view this issue, and also what they may want to do in the future on this issue. I think that would add a great deal to the message. I'd like it to be international. To the extent that you can help us identify people who may want to speak to this, they would need to know it's going to be seen by a great many people. As you know, the unacknowledged documentary has been seen by 650 million people.
Our suggestion is as follows. We can film these interviews, their answers to your questions, here in Russia with our filming crew. When we render these videos, we can send it to you, and you can do the montage and everything.
I have a man who'd be doing in America it's called the director of photography, could work with your crew to, so it is fits the right, looks good, because what we want this to do is to be something high quality that would be appealing to, you know, we really want to get this to 1 or 2 billion people.
We can absolutely do this. We have a lot of experience in this, and we have special people who do this all the time. And they are paid for this, so...
That's awesome. Wonderful. Well, thank you.
And by the way, I wanted to share something with you. I understand what you're talking about when you talk about lucid dreams.
Mm-hmm.
Because
yes.
I've had the same. And
yes.
And besides that, I've had contacts with ETs too.
Right. Yes. Yeah, I'm sure you have if you're at this level.
The speeches that you gave that I watched on YouTube, and each time you talked... about these issues, I was saying to myself, oh, I had this too. Oh, just like I had many times.
Well, I hope we can meet sometime. Maybe I can come over if there's nothing else. Do you have any other pressing question or that I cover most?
You have covered everything that I have written down, because you had a story to tell, and that's step by step, just like I have written my questions.
My mind works that way. I do this so that... It's this way my mind operates. But well, look, I hope we'll speak again soon. And so I really appreciate your help and also arranging for the interviews with these key people in your country, because I think it will add a lot to the message for peace around the world.
We will brief them on your questions so they could speak about the treaty on the prevention of placement of weapons in outer space, about the ETs, that they are friendly, about the this false flag operations, that this is all false, that is all a lie, and what the truth is, and what we have to do in case of, if we see this scenario happening. So everything this, we will try to include in this message.
Great.
So
wonderful.
To contribute to this documentary, I think that's a great idea to educate the public. At least they will know, at least they will see a different message.
I think we can get it out in a very large way. Now, one thing I don't know how to do is to get it out into other populations that aren't dominated by Western technology companies. such as in Russia, but also China, for example. I don't have anyone to get something like this on, I think it's called Tencent. I mean, I know they have the equivalent of Amazon and Netflix in China. And I guess in Russia, you may have a platform.
Yeah, so we will spread this documentary in Russia through all these okay. social networks. And so, of course, we have Facebook, too. And we have, like, Russian Facebook, it's called. So you don't have to know this.
Okay.
We'll spread there as well.
Right. Wonderful.
I just wanted to emphasize that what you have said about your lucid dream of this bright future,
yeah.
I think that's a key thing in our activities to keep this future coming, to keep yes. it inside and to project it into the outside world, to shape this reality in a positive and peaceful way.
Yes. Well, we're probably going to spend $50,000 to $75,000 in this educational film at the end, just to portray that vision at the end and saying that here's what we need to avoid, here's what we can do and what the world will be when we do this for peace and for a peaceful way. So we're going to have some of the best graphics people in the world create that so that the movie ends in a very positive, hopeful, forward-looking, you know. By the way, this idea for this just came to me yesterday morning, so I'm still working.
and you can rely on our help as well.
Great. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Greer. Bye.
Nice speaking with you. Bye.